It is now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Thank you, and good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Finance. February 21, 2017, the Minister of Finance said, quote, "We're looking at a balanced budget in this coming budget, next year as well, and the year after that."
Qu'est-ce qui se passe?
Wrong. The province's books will be balanced this spring and for the foreseeable future, insists Finance Minister Charles Souza. Quote, wrong. The Minister of Finance again said, "I will confirm that we are on track to deliver balanced budgets for the next 2 years as well." Wrong. This government can't be trusted. Mr. Speaker, after 2 years of promising a balanced budget, how does the Finance Minister think he has any credibility left with the people of Ontario?
Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, we have worked hard and long to slay the deficit throughout the past 5 years. Mr. Speaker, because of the hard work of the people of this province, we also have a surplus, Mr. Speaker, right here and now. Over the last 40 years, the Conservatives have balanced the budget only three times, Mr. Speaker. During the federal government, they've recorded the largest deficits in history and the largest debt accumulation anywhere in Canada's history. We're balanced, we're in surplus, and we're going to continue to work for the people of Ontario.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. I'm now going to use this round as to tell us that we're in warnings. While the minister was answering, even his own side was making heckling noises that I was made it difficult for me to hear, and both sides need to bring it down a tone, and if you don't, I will. Supplementary.
Back to the minister. Well, again, the Minister of Finance said, quote, "We have outperformed, and as a result, we're coming to balance next year and the year after that." His fall economic statement said, quote, "The government is continuing to project a balanced budget 2017-18 and ongoing balance in 18-19 and 2019-20. News reports announced Souza confirmed last fall that Ontario's 2018 budget will be balanced. As will budgets over the next 2 years, Speaker, none of that was correct. This is the opposite of the truth spread by a government willing to say anything to power. Mr.
Getting very close to saying something you know would be unparliamentary. Don't do that tip rope for me, please. And if you do, I'll ask you to withdraw the next time.
Mr. Speaker, how can the Minister of Finance tell us one thing when he knows the complete opposite to be true?
Thank you, Minister.
So we've taken a hard stand, disciplined and determined approach to balance the budget this year and to have a surplus now. Now we have a choice. Now the Conservatives have made their choice. They have already said they are going into deficit. And they further say that they're going to make cuts through a lot of revenue generation, including carbon pricing. They have a $16 billion hole in their plan, Mr. Speaker. What are they going to cut? What are they going to do? We made our choice here. Mr. Speaker, we've chosen to support mental health. We've chosen to support social services. We're choosing to support students and elder care. We could choose not to do those things, Mr. Speaker.
Answer.
In these uncertain times, we choose to support them, recognizing that there's some turbulence in the market. We are not going to let anybody behind.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Final supplementary.
Back to the minister. Let me read more quotes. Finance, quote, Finance Minister Charles Souza announced that not only will the province's budget be balanced this year, it will continue to not slip into deficit into 2018 or 19 as well. Now, we know that's not accurate. The 2017 budget read, not only are we presenting a balanced budget this year, we are on track for balanced budgets in 18, 19, 2020, and 1920. We know that's not accurate. After 2 years of promising a balanced budget, I guess we can't be surprised the minister decided to support Liberal insiders instead. Mr. Speaker, we need to know, was it the Premier who made the Minister of Finance run an $8 billion deficit?
Thank you. Minister.
Came over here.
So, Mr. Speaker, we are tracking to remain fiscally responsible for the province of Ontario.
You bet we are, unlike you.
The people of Ontario have asked.
So we are. The member from Bruce Gray Owen Sound is warned.
They've asked us to manage government finances effectively. They've also asked us to help them manage their finances as well. We could choose not to do that, Mr. Speaker. We could choose not to support mental health. We could choose not to support hospitals. We could choose not to support students and more education. We could choose not to support elder care and seniors care. We could choose not to do those things just to stay in balance. But we chose our values, and our values are shared with the people of Ontario.
Yeah,
and they value us to help them, and we're not going to cut them as they
will. Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you. New question. The Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Health. Speaker, I want to start by running through the facts. There are currently more than 20 or 32,000 seniors on the waiting list for a long-term care bed in Ontario. And with
tough luck. Minister of Treasury Board is warned. Please finish.
Without increased capacity, the wait list is expected to reach almost 50,000 in the next 3 years. There's no that speaker, that is no way to treat society's most vulnerable. Ontario can and must do much better. The Liberals' Band-Aid solutions simply are not enough. Mr. Speaker, will the Liberal government commit to building 15,000 new long-term care beds over 5 years and 30,000 beds over the next 10 years.
Thank you. Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Speaker. And as we've said so many times in this House, every Ontarian deserves to grow old with dignity in a safe, secure and compassionate environment. In fact, as I believe the members opposite have heard from our Minister of Finance, very much the theme of our budget this year will be about caring for those individuals in society who, of course, deserve the very best health care possible. And so we've been clear since last year's budget, and in fact throughout our term, that support for the long-term care sector is very important, and this is why we continue to make critical investments in this sector. And so our funding for long-term care homes has increased by some $348 million just since 2013. Our investment in long-term care homes increased by $80.5 million this year alone, and I'll continue to explain our commitments in the supplementary.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Back to the minister. In Northern Ontario, seniors make up the greatest percentage of the population, larger than any region in the province. In Nipissing, the North Bay Regional Health Centre has experienced overcrowding due to the lack of long-term care beds available. The closing of Lady Isabel has pushed more and more patients to North Bay Regional Health Centre, leading to the overcrowding and hallway medicine at that hospital. It is imperative that Lady Isabel long-term care facility is replaced.
The Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services is warned. Carry on.
Speaker, Mr. Speaker, it is imperative that Lady Isabel is replaced by another long-term care home in Trout Creek. No senior should have to wait 5 years for a nursing bed. So, Mr. Speaker, why does this government believe having seniors wait 5 years for a long-term bed is acceptable?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And of course, through the last number of years since we took office, we have opened over 10,000 new long-term care beds and redeveloped 13,500 long-term care beds. And specifically in the north, I have a very long list of homes that have been redeveloped in that time. And we will continue to look at the
Excuse me. Don't give me that much choice. It's like a candy store. That'll do. You got the message. Quiet. Carry on.
And we will continue to work with our LIN partners to establish where the need is greatest and where we need to establish more long-term care facilities. Just in the last few years, I'd like to draw the members' attention to Résidence Saint-Joseph in Sudbury that was opened in March of 2011, Extendicare in Sault Ste. Marie in April 2013, Extendicare in Timmins, October 2013. Thank you.
Supplement.
Thank you, Speaker. Back to the Minister. In my own riding in Nipissing, there's a desperate need for more long-term care beds. Castle Home in North Bay is seeking redevelopment, something the government first announced in 2010. Back then, it was a $40 million project. Today, for the exact same project, it is now a $60 million project. While nothing has happened for almost a decade, our needs have become even greater. A local councillor has said that, quote, 16 additional beds will be applied for, which would be the most efficient use of additional space to the current building design. Mr. Speaker, will the government support the redevelopment and additional beds for Castle Home?
Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, as we've made very clear, we will be investing in 5,000 new long-term care beds over the next 4 years, as well as providing 15 million more hours of nursing, personal support, and therapeutic care annually for residents in long-term care homes. There was a call for applications that closed just last Friday. We are reviewing those very closely as we speak, and no doubt announcements will be made in the near future. But what I don't understand, Mr. Speaker, is that the opposition parties have in their people's guarantee, we don't know if that's going to be their platform, but in that document, there was no money for hospitals or for long-term care.
Thank you,
Mr. Speaker.
New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
I want to start by wishing everyone around the Legislature and women across the province a happy International Women's Day, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Acting Premier. Joe Glowacki is a Londoner. He reached out to the MPP from London West this week because he was angry about the Premier's response to her question about Stuart Klein. Mr. Glowacki said that it was inexcusable for the Premier to deflect blame to the insurance company for Mr. Klein's heartbreaking story and refused to take responsibility for what happened. He said he knows that Mr. Klein's family was telling the truth because the same thing happened to him in December. Why won't the Premier and this Liberal government take responsibility for what's been happening to families like the Kleins?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And of course, we do acknowledge the tragedy that occurred in this particular case with this family. And both the Premier and I have expressed our deep condolences, of course, to the family. We know that our healthcare professionals on the ground are always ready to assist in situations like this. We know that there are beds available for critical care patients in Ontario, and we are absolutely committed to ensuring that the communication between people, the insurance companies, and our health professionals is improved and looked at very, very carefully. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, on December 1st, Joe Glowacki suffered a heart attack while he was in Arizona with his wife. He was rushed to the hospital and was stabilized and ready to be transported the very next day. But Joe's insurance company told him that there were no beds available at home. The insurance company had even lined up a cardiologist at London Health Sciences to take care of him. But Joe spent three more days in that Arizona hospital before his insurance company sent him home on a commercial flight with orders to see his doctor immediately. Can the Acting Premier tell Joe and his wife Beverly why he never did get a hospital bed in Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And as we've said, there are beds available in these situations. What appears to be happening is that there's a breakdown in communication between potentially, and I'm just speculating the many, many steps involved in situations like this. There are physicians involved in the country where the resident is traveling. There are physicians here ready to discuss the individual case. There are LHIN staff responsible for the coordination regionally. And certainly my ministry officials are always ready to go the extra mile to ensure the highest quality of care for Ontarians. We are going to do everything in our power to ensure that families have confidence that their loved ones returning from abroad will be able to receive the care they need here in Ontario.
Do final supplementary.
Well, Speaker, I can assure the minister that nobody has any confidence that the people that are traveling are going to get the care that they need if they have to come home in an emergency situation. It is failing over and over and over in our province. The breakdown is not in communications. The breakdown is in our hospital system, and it's a breakdown that this Liberal government has caused because of cuts and underfunding. That's the breakdown, Speaker. Joe Kowalski, Stuart Klein, David Ronald, Danny Marchand, Larry Dan, all of these people were told that they couldn't go home because there were no beds available when they faced a health care emergency. Can the acting premier tell us right now how many more Ontarians waiting in pain will have to take time to convince somebody that the overcrisis in this system is a real thing and not just a communications problem with insurance companies?
Thank you. Minister.
Apparently, the leader of the third party didn't understand that there were beds available in these cases. But we are asking questions about how this disconnect is occurring, and we will work to ensure all Ontarians can benefit from our health care system, whether at home or abroad. I will be inviting members of the insurance associations to directly meet with officials from the Ministry of Health and myself. What is clear is that there are beds available in Ontario for patients travelling from abroad, and I look forward to discussing ways in which we can facilitate communication from the insurance companies to the hospitals and make sure all Ontarians are able to get home in a safe and timely manner. Thank you.
Thank you. New question, Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you. This is also to the Acting Premier, Speaker. For the Kleins, Ronalds and Glowackis, the hospital overcrowding and hallway medicine crisis means watching a loved one stuck in a foreign hospital. For other families, it means watching a loved one spend 24 hours in a chair in a busy ER in pain, or a wife watching her husband suffer as his heart surgery gets rescheduled for the fourth time. For families in Kitchener-Waterloo, it means waiting, or worrying rather, that your local hospital is operating well over what experts consider a safe capacity. Yesterday, I revealed that the pediatric mental health unit at Grand River Hospital in Kitchener-Waterloo reached an astonishing 100% occupancy in November. Why are the Premier and her Liberal government?
Minister of Tourism, Culture and Sport is warned. Finish, please.
Why are the Premier and her Liberal government still refusing to admit that hospitals in Ontario are facing consistent overcrowding that is negatively affecting families?
Acting Premier.
The Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you so much, Mr. Speaker. And again, we are turning to the situation where we are absolutely committed to improving the situation in hospitals. This is precisely why last fall we invested in some 1,200 additional hospital beds. The member opposite perhaps doesn't recall that in the 2017 budget we invested over $500 million in funding, over $500 million in Ontario hospitals. It means that all Ontario hospitals are receiving at a minimum a 2% increase in funding this year. It's a significant new investment in hospitals. It'll mean reduced wait times, better access to more procedures, and an improved experience for all Ontarians at their local hospitals. We know that this has been a difficult winter. We know we've had a very bad flu season. This has been adding to the pressures on our hospitals, but we have a plan to address this situation, Mr.
Absolutely.
Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, after 15 years, they're trying to improve a system that they created a crisis in the first place. That's the problem that we have in Ontario. And let's face it, the 2017 budget fell $300 million short of what the hospital said they needed as a bare minimum to keep a system in crisis, you know, moving along in a very bad state. Freedom of information documents also reveal that the mental health unit at Grand River was operating at or above 100% capacity every single month from September through December. Surgery, stroke, medicine units were over 100% in nearly every month in the same period. The MPP for Kitchener-Waterloo said that hospital overcrowding stories are now the top issue that she's getting in her constituency office. This overcrowding crisis is real, and it is not going away, and it needs to be fixed now. When will this Premier and this Liberal government actually take some action?
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and of course that's exactly what we're doing. Yeah. We've been planning not only in the hospital sector but in all the other pieces of the healthcare system. We've opened some 503 transitional care spaces out of hospital for up to 1,700 patients who don't require care in a hospital, those alternative level of care patients. But specifically at Grand River Hospital, I'd like to ensure that the member opposite knows that we certainly value the great work that's being done by our healthcare partners, all those frontline workers in the Waterloo region as a whole. In specifically to Grand River Hospital, we added 14 additional beds, and through the 2017 budget, the government increased annual funding to Grand River Hospital by $5.5 million to continue to support them in their delivery of high-quality health care.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, frontline healthcare workers in our province are stressed to the max. They are run off their feet. They leave work in tears because they're not able to provide the quality of care that they know they should be providing to the people of the province. And that problem sits on the foot of this government, who has been cutting back hospital budgets for years and years and years. This crisis is absolutely a result of decades of bad decisions, bad choices by this Liberal government and the Conservative government before them. It didn't happen overnight, but it has been getting worse under this particular Premier's watch. What is it going to take for the Premier and her Liberal government to admit that this is not just a flu season surge, but rather the result of decades of cuts to health care services and hospitals that Ontario families rely on?
Mr. Speaker, to set the record straight, since 2003, we've increased our investments in healthcare each and every year, allowing us to treat more patients, provide better care, and reduce wait times to some of the shortest in the country, actually validated by the Fraser Institute, you will recall. So, in addition to our assistance to Grand River Hospital, we have in the Waterloo region construction of the Groves Memorial Hospital well underway to expand capacity in the region, and we know that all three Waterloo hospitals are participating in the dedicated offload nurses program. We do value both our paramedic services and the nurses in the ER, and we're doing everything we can to ensure that there's a smooth transition of patients into the hospital. And so we are providing some $16 million to municipalities to provide additional resources in this regard. And lest we forget, what did the NDP during their time in office? They closed 24% of acute hospital beds, closed 13% of mental health beds in the hospital.
I stand, you sit, Minister. New question. The member from Scarborough Rouge River.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This question is for the Minister of Finance. Before the 2014 election, Premier Cashin Wynne promised to reduce the auto insurance rates by 15%. The Premier later on called the 15% reduction is nothing but a stretch goal. Yet, today, the average auto insurance premium in Ontario is still almost 55% higher than the average of all other Canadian provinces. Can we record this as another broken election promises? Why would Ontarians ever trust this Liberal government say?
Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, as a member opposite, I believe, would know, we have just brought forward a whole
a slew of initiatives to try to reduce the fraud within the system, which is causing the premiums to go up. And as the member knows, we put forward.
The member from Whitby Oshawa is warned. Carry on.
We've worked with David Marshall, who's brought in 35 recommendations, one of which is to provide a standard treatment plan to eliminate some of the nonsense that happens with the most common of injuries. Another one is to provide an independent examination center to avoid conflicts of interest so that people are assessed effectively. The other one is a serious fraud office to go after those who are committing some of the fraud so we can go and attend to that and put some teeth within the commitment with OPP officers. The other one is FISCO and the Financial Services Authority, who are going to look at the Postal Code Initiative to try to curb some of the activity, and of course contingency fees and the legal community, and address some of those issues so that consumers and victims are protected.
Answer.
And all in all, we have an expert panel that's alleviating some of these stresses, and we are working. And the rates have gone down on average. We need to ensure that they remain even lower.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Through you to the Minister of Finance. The rating I represent comprises of postal codes M1S, M1B, M1X, and M1B. According to Kinetics.ca, the residents of these postal codes pay the highest auto insurance rates in Canada. Why are Scarborough Rouge River riding residents being gouged by the Catherine Liberals? Didn't you get the message during the 2016 by-election?
Thank you. Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I mean, I appreciate the member trying to be cute with the question, but the fact of the matter is those postal codes and those initiatives have severe impacts on the overall.
The member from Niagara West Glenbrook is warned. Carry on.
And we're addressing those very initiatives through the Financial Services Regulatory Authority that has a consumer office, and they're looking at those postal codes. The member may suggest that we reduce them on one end, but then you're going to increase it in the northern parts of Ontario. That's not fair as well, Mr. Speaker. We need to get after the root causes. That's what we are doing. We need to initiate and alleviate some of the stresses in those postal codes by implementing these programs, and I hope the member opposite will agree with them, so that we can foster some reduction in those rates and go after those communities and help those people who are affected in those urban locations.
New question, the member from Essex.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Acting Premier. Speaker, I want to welcome members from Waterwells First, who are here to fight for safe, clean drinking water for their communities. Speaker, water is life. Without it, nothing survives. But for a long time now, families in Chatham-Kent have been dealing with black water coming from their wells, jeopardizing their lives and their livelihoods. Water on family farms that surround Samsung's North Kent One wind turbine site became black and undrinkable when Samsung began construction on these turbines. That's no coincidence. This Liberal government says that the water is safe to drink, nothing to look at, and that these families are overreacting. Well, I've seen firsthand what the water looks like, and the scientists that have shown that sediment is actually black shale, which is known to carry heavy metals like arsenic, lead, and uranium. My question is to the Acting Premier, why does this Liberal government refuse to do a simple health hazard investigation to provide certainty for these families?
Acting Premier.
Speaker, Minister of Indigenous Relations and Reconciliation, acting as the Minister of the Environment and the Climate Change.
Minister of Indigenous Relations and Reconciliation, acting on behalf of the Minister of the Environment.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, I can tell you that the Ministry of the Environment and Climate Change takes these matters of groundwater quality very seriously.
Absolutely.
The Ministry has undertaken a review of water quality data to ensure residents the water is safe. And thus far, the analysis has not shown a connection between water quality and the construction activity. The company has informed the ministry that they are working with homeowners to provide and pay for licensed well contractors to inspect their wells and to answer any questions that they may have regarding this issue.
That's good.
Thank you. Supplementary.
What an unbelievable answer from the acting minister or whatever he is. These families are not just worried about the quality of the water in their wells for their own sake. Many of them operate commercial farms. They need water to keep their livestock alive. But because scientists have shown how dangerous it is to drink, some of them are watering them with bottled water. They think it's unethical to give contaminated water to their livestock and other families to consume. It's unacceptable that this Liberal government is taking the word over Samsung, and it's a sad day in Ontario where this is the quality of water that the government, the Premier...
Stop the clock. The member will take a seat. The member is now warned. And if such an outburst happens again, the member will be named. Minister.
The ministry had a very...
Regretfully, the member is named. Member from Essex. I've always respected the members visiting here. I must remind you that no participation is allowed. Response.
Speaker, in the face of that diatribe, here is a fact. The Chatham-Kent Medical Officer of Health has confirmed that the water particulates do not possess a health risk to residents. In fact, there was a production.
I wish I knew who it was, but I have a suspicion it's the person hiding their face, hiding their mouth with their hands. I'm not sure. You have a wrap-up, please.
2 weeks ago, Water Wells first met with the ministry staff. They shared the results of the extensive testing, and again, the Chatham-Kent Medical Officer of Health has confirmed that the water particulates do not propose a health risk. Speaker, we will continue to monitor the well impacts closely during the construction and the operation of the turbine.
The member from Windsor West is warned. New question. Member from Ottawa South.
Thank you much, Mr. Speaker. Speaker, I understand that the date has been selected for the 2018 Ontario budget, and I know there's plenty of speculation on what that budget will include. And, Minister, I know that we've already made important investments for the people of Ontario, investments that are changing people's lives, like free pharmacare for everyone under 25 that has already benefited nearly 1 million people in just 2 months. We've made college and post-secondary education more accessible, and nearly 200,000 students will be leaving university and college with less debt through free tuition. And we've raised the minimum wage, making workplaces fairer for hardworking people across this province. And I know that the people of Ontario are looking forward to the budget. And, Mr. Speaker, can the minister please tell us the date?
Question. Thank you. Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, thank you to the member from Ottawa South. And I wish to announce officially in this House that the Ontario budget will be delivered on Wednesday, March 28th. I'll have the pleasure and the privilege of delivering my sixth budget. And this budget is about making a choice, a value choice. It's about values shared by the people of Ontario. We remain committed to what matters most to them, continuing to invest in childcare, health care, and in mental health. Care that the people of Ontario depend upon, because we know a healthier Ontario, where no one is left behind, is without doubt a stronger Ontario, Mr. Speaker. We'll not stop fighting for the people of Ontario.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and again to the Minister of Finance. As the parliamentary assistant to the Minister of Health, I'm proud of the investments we've made in things like palliative care and home care. But we do know that no matter who emerges as the new Conservative leader, they have no plan for climate change. And that leaves a $16 billion black hole in their guarantee. And that hole they'll have to fill with people's jobs and the services that they need. Services like OHIP Plus, new hospitals, new schools. and we know that they're going to deny the minimum wage. So I ask the minister if he remains committed to building new schools, new hospitals, public transit, if he remains committed into investing in things like support for the most vulnerable, 100,000 new child care spaces. Mr. Speaker, to the minister.
Thank you. Minister.
Absolutely, Mr. Speaker. The difference between us and the party opposite isn't just one of dollars and decisions. Mr. Speaker, it's about values. And in the face of some uncertainty, with real economic anxiety, I've heard throughout my pre-budget consultations across the province, we must continue to invest in our greatest strength, and that, of course, is the people of Ontario. It's these hard-working Ontarians that created nearly 800,000 net new jobs since the recession. Mr. Speaker, Ontarians need to know, what will the Conservatives cut from their $16 billion fiscal hole? Is it $20 billion from our new and upgraded hospitals? Will they cut the $7 billion booster shot to health care supports? Or are they going to cut the $16 billion in infrastructure for schools? On this side of the House, we remain committed to creating more opportunities for the people of Ontario, and we will not let the Conservatives put these cuts into programs and put Ontario at risk.
New question, the member from Elgin, Middlesex, London.
Thank you, Speaker. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry. Speaker, for 7 years I've been trying to get a simple answer from the government regarding the Fish and Wildlife Special Purpose Account, with little or no success. This account pools together all revenues from fishing and hunting license fees and royalties, and must be reinvested back into wildlife resource management. Unfortunately, instead of using these funds for their intended purposes, this government continues to use this account as a personal slush fund. Speaker, they spend it on dinners, they spend it on housekeeping services, psychologists, buying and selling and renting housing. Can the minister, the new minister, explain how any of the above related items that I mentioned have anything to do with wildlife conservation in Ontario?
Thank you, Minister of Natural Resources and Forestry.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. I'm happy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I think, and we will have the occasion this afternoon to continue to debate this issue. Now, I don't really understand why anyone would object to the fact that this funding has allowed us to stock almost 8 million fish in a year in lakes all across Ontario, to have conservation officers to enforce our laws and ensure that fish, there continues to be fish, and that we don't overhunt or overfish. Invest in a great public education program, learn to fish. 4,000 people have learned to fish effectively, safely, and sustainably through that program. It conducts research. Now, people need to be there to do this work, and I think part of it, does the member object to people being paid or having benefits? Yeah. I think that's the problem. I think it's, we want to ensure that we continue to deliver this program effectively, and that requires people, and people should be paid and have access to benefits. Thank you.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. No one's objecting to the fund. In fact, the Progressive Conservative Party created the fund. This government has corrupted the fund, unfortunately, Mr. Speaker. Through the lack of transparency, this government continues to disrespect our hunters and anglers throughout this province. Today, when we debate my private member's bill to return transparency to the special purpose account and create a system for hunters and anglers to inquire about the expenditures, will the minister do the right thing? Support my bill, ensuring all monies collected from these fees goes directly to wildlife conservation and not paying for someone's steak dinner.
Good question. I support it.
Mr. Speaker, I think the fund is used appropriately, and it is monitored. It has a lot of people. There's an advisory panel that does provide advice. And indeed, I'm not the only one saying this. There's a quote from Mr. Angelo Lombardo, which is the executive director of the Ontario Federation of Anglers and Hunters, who does support this fund and says, and I quote, "We need to remember that resource management needs people. We can't grow and stock fish without people. We can't do assessment and surveys without people. We can't do research without people. And these people, sir, need to be paid, and they need to be paid. And we've been spending the entire week talking about mental health and the benefits, having people that have access to benefits such as mental health benefits is important. I think we stand by this fund. It has done great things to Ontario and will continue to do the work.
New question, the member from Nickelbelt.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Francophone Minister. Today, we have hundreds of young people who are participating in the Parliament, and they would like to know, when you gave the mandate to Mrs. Diana Dunn for the planning of a French university, you insisted that the university should have a governance for and by Francophones, meaning administration, student life, academic life, research, and infrastructure. The governance for and by Francophones, is it by the Toronto Francophones or by all Ontario Francophones? Thank you very much for the question. And once again, I would like to welcome our young parliamentarians here. It is a pleasure to welcome you every year. You know, a Francophone university is a historical moment for us in Ontario. We will have a university with a governance by and for Francophones, and I am very proud to improve the offer of services in French, especially in the Southwest Centre, year after year, and report after report, and also from the community of Toronto. They all told us that there was a necessity to have that type of program. So it is with pleasure that we will continue our work with the Francophone community.
Please.
That's called baiting. He gets the warning, you get the boot. Just thought I'd let you know. I'm aware of that game. Supplementary.
I told you that we're asking questions, but we're not always receiving answers. Last fall, you finally talked about Mr. François Boileau, our French Services Commissioner, for changing the law on French services. The Commissioner presented his report in June 2016. The law on French services is over 30 years. The Liberal government has been in power for 15 years. The report is on your desk for 2 years. So when are we going to amend the law on French services? Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you again for the question. Look, I committed and I'm still committed to modernize this 30 years old voice. I met the community during the last 18 months, and what I hear from them is that we need to have quality services in French. Mr. Speaker, in my mandate, it is necessary to create an action plan to be able to meet the needs of this French services. And thank you for the commissioner on his report. He improved French services, so we fully committed, Mr. Speaker, to an action plan which will allow us to support and to improve the process of designation, and we will go forward with a pilot project which will bring us to a more efficient designation, and in the end we will improve French services in our province, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
From London North Centre.
Thank you, Speaker. And my question is for the Minister of Community and Social Services. Speaker, today is International Women's Day, a day when we celebrate women's achievements throughout history and across nations and continue the work for a more equitable society. Appropriately, Speaker, last week we announced the unprecedented investment of $242 million in Ontario's new gender-based violence strategy. This is tremendously exciting. It shows our government's continued commitment to ending gender-based violence in Ontario. Speaker, I've seen firsthand the extraordinary work that violence against women agencies like ANOVA in my community of London do every day. We know that violence against women agencies provide crucial services like emergency shelter, counseling, and transition and housing supports to help women and their children rebuild their lives.
Question.
Speaker, can the minister tell the House what this new gender-based violence strategy will mean for violence against women's shelters and services across Ontario?
Minister of Community and Social Services.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I want to thank the member for her tireless advocacy on this issue. She's been really important in moving this file forward. Thank you so much. I want to thank all of the VAW agencies across the province and their staff who worked so much to support this initiative. I'm thrilled to share an announcement that we made last week, including $150 million over 3 years towards increased services and support for women and their children who have experienced domestic violence. Mr. Speaker, that means 1,000 more women and children will have a safe bed when they're escaping domestic violence. It means 2,000 more women and their children will receive critical counseling services when needed. And this means more inclusive services to better respond to the needs of the LGBTQ plus Indigenous, Francophone, newcomer, and racialized communities. I'm so proud to be part of a government
Thank you,
Mr.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the minister for that answer. I have to tell you, I'm very proud to be part of a government that recognizes the need for strong services for women and survivors. So whether it's women in the workplace or women facing sexual assault or domestic violence, our government has worked hard to make sure that women feel safe. The investment that the Minister of Community and Social Services outlined will most definitely be a positive step to ensure all women feel protected. However, Speaker, we recognize that victim supports is only one part of the solution. We know that another part is ensuring the justice system is more responsive to the needs of survivors. We know that the justice system can be hard, if not truly intimidating. I know that I have heard clearly that the current process needs to be more survivor-centric and trauma-informed. Can the minister please tell us about the investments we've made to help those survivors in the justice system?
Thank you, Minister.
Attorney General.
Attorney General.
Speaker, it's a great honour to get a question from the great Dab Matthews. Speaker, as my colleague has mentioned, it's never okay. And Me Too seized on a conversation, and this conversation has grown. Survivors are coming forward. They are demanding change and support. And, Speaker, we need to answer. Within the justice system, we are doing this in two ways, by strengthening our support for survivors and those at risk, and by working to ensure that our justice system is responsive to the needs of survivors and their families. Speaker, this includes a 35% increase to the overall budget for sexual assault centers and providing free legal advice to survivors province-wide. Speaker, these investments will have a massive impact for survivors all across Ontario. But, Speaker, as I look across the floor to the official opposition, I see an opposition that has a plan that includes billions of dollars in cuts.
Wow.
I would like to tell this House that even $1 billion in cuts, Speaker, at my ministry would completely scrap this new investment, which will not be acceptable.
Thank you. New question, the member from Thorn Hill.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. A question to the Minister of Education. 4 years ago, the Liberal government decided to considerably reduce the number of students in colleges in Ontario because there were a lack of teachers. People in the Francophone community told the government not to reduce the training of Francophone teachers because it was already obvious for them that there was a lack of Francophone teachers. As per usual, this government ignored advice of people who know this field the best, and they decided to get rid of few spots for Francophone teachers training. Mr. Speaker, could the minister explain why her government ignored that advice and decided to reduce the training for Francophone teachers? Thank you. The Minister of Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I just want to thank the member opposite for this important question. And I want to say to you that I actually had a discussion just this morning on this very issue with l'Association franco-ontarienne des conseils scolaires catholiques. This is absolutely an issue that many in the French community are raising. And I want you to know that we are working diligently and tirelessly to ensure that we're dealing with the shortage of French teachers in our province. I also want you to know that this is not an issue that is just specific to our province. I've actually had conversations with ministers of education from other provinces who are also trying to make sure that they have the pieces in place to deal with this. The reality is that we recognize the tremendous advantage students have when they speak more than one language, and we want to make sure that we are supporting French as a second language and the demand for FSL as much as we can. And so we are doing a number of things on a number of different levels to deal with this issue, and I'm happy to speak about that in the supplementary.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Again to the minister. It is this government's fault. It is their responsibility. They're the reason why we have this problem. Hundreds of children in the southwestern school district in Ontario do not have qualified French teachers. I've met South Asian families in South Brampton who are furious because there is no spot for their children in French immersion. Mr. Speaker, the government is investing taxpayers' money in French services and in Francophone University. Could the minister explain to us then who is using these French services and go to the and use these programs if we do not teach Ontarian students to the French language?
Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to take this question, and I just want to point out once again that we are very aware of this challenge, and we are actually working very tirelessly to make sure that we're taking care of this challenge and ensuring that we are meeting the demand. The reality is, Mr. Speaker, that the demand for FSL is exceeding the supply of teachers, but we are taking immediate steps to boost the recruitment of new French teachers. Once again, an issue that other provinces are dealing with across the country. So here's what we're doing. We're developing information campaigns that inform internationally educated teachers about the opportunities of teaching in Ontario. We are creating bridging programs to help newcomers adjust and mentoring opportunities. We're streamlining evaluation of credentials for internationally educated Francophone teachers. We're working to increase access to the profession, and we're creating a new supply and demand forecasting model so we can be more responsive. The reality is, Mr. Speaker, we are on it. We're doing a number of things. We're not complaining about the issue. We're actually having conversations and coming up with solutions and working with our partners to take care of the problem.
Your question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is for the Acting Premier. For years, this Liberal government has starved hospitals of the funding they need, and they're still at it, Speaker. Instead of funding every hospital properly, we've learned that the Premier is actually clawing money back from Kenora's Hospital. Yep. At the beginning of February, Lake of the Woods District Hospital was projecting a balanced budget. Now, after clawbacks from this government, they're facing a huge deficit. And every time this government cuts hospital funding, patients are the ones to pay the price, with longer wait times and even more overcrowding. That's the last thing that Northwestern Ontario needs, Speaker. Why is this government cutting funding for Kenora's Hospital when every hospital in Ontario needs more investment, not less?
Speaker, the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I guess I will just repeat the type of plan that we have for Ontario's hospitals. I know that the member is aware that in the 2017 budget we invested over $500 million in funding in Ontario hospitals. So this was a major increase. This is what we've been doing each and every year. The demographics of Ontario is precisely what we're studying very, very closely. We're looking at individual communities. Our local health integration networks are studying the needs in their particular community. As I'm sure the member knows, these
LHINs are governed by local people. We value their input. We will be looking very closely as we move forward with our plan to improve hospital capacity at individual needs. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Speaker, I didn't want the minister to repeat a failed plan. I wanted her to explain why she's cutting money from the Kenora Hospital. The government just doesn't seem to get it, Speaker. Hospitals have been starved for years by the Liberals and then before them by the Conservatives. We have a dangerous overcrowding crisis. People are being treated in hallways for days on end. And instead of fixing the problems and funding our hospitals properly, we find out that the Liberals are cutting funding for this crucial hospital and making it harder for the people of Northwestern Ontario to get the health care that they need. Why won't this government stop the hospital cuts once and for all and stop cutting Kenora's hospital funding?
Thank you. Minister.
And I only need to repeat our plan because apparently it isn't sinking in. I have to say that we are continuing not only to invest in hospitals, but in all aspects of the healthcare system. And quite seriously, if the leader of the third party continues to fearmonger in this way, I really find it distressing. The NDP voted against a budget that provided an additional $5.8 million for Health Sciences North this year alone and more than $30 million in investments for Northern hospitals. Lest we forget, the NDP also voted against our OHIP Plus plan that would have seen nearly 25,000 children and youth in the Sudbury area have free access to over 4,400 eligible prescription medications. And if NDP leader Andrea Horvath is serious about investing in health care, then she should have supported the 2017 budget, where we increased health care funding.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Davenport.
Speaker, as you know, today is International Women's Day. I want to take this opportunity to wish all the women here today, all the women in my riding of Davenport, and my mother, Arminda Bento, a happy International Women's Day. Today is a day to celebrate the incredible accomplishments of women past and present. It is also a day to recognize the work we still need to do to create a fair and equal society. My question, Speaker, is for the Minister of the Status of Women. We know that this last year has been remarkable for women. Women and girls across the world have come forward demanding change. The Me Too and Time's Up movements have signaled a call to action. Can the Minister of the Status of Women tell us what the government is doing to respond to these important calls for action, for change?
Minister for the Status of Women.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to my colleague for this very important question on this very important day. Speaker, this week our government introduced two groundbreaking strategies. Then, Now, Next, our Women's Economic Empowerment Strategy, and It's Never Okay, Ontario's Gender-Based Violence Strategy. These strategies build on the work that on our government's commitment to a fair and equal society for everyone, regardless of your gender, gender identity, or expression. It's Never Okay, Ontario's Gender-Based Violence Strategy, with an investment of up to $242 million, responds to that call to action and the social change that we are in. It has been 43 years since the United Nations officially recognized International Women's Day. We have accomplished so much in that time, but we still have far to go. This is why our government is fully committed to gender equality and to improving economic achievements of women. That is why we're building a fairer and more equal Ontario that includes historic new investments for women and girls in this province.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thank you to the Minister. It is clear that the future is changing for generations of women and girls in Ontario. I am pleased to see our government building on our commitment to create a province free from domestic and sexual violence. Speaker, gender-based violence can happen to anyone, but women and children are most at risk. The risk is even greater for women who are racialized, Indigenous, newcomers, LGBTQ2, or living with disabilities. We know that women often face other barriers that get in the way of their opportunity to fully participate in our society. The minister mentioned Then, Now, Next, Ontario's Women's Economic Empowerment Strategy. Can the minister outline how this strategy will benefit women and girls in this province?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you again for the question. It's time for all women's. It is the time for all women's economic empowerment. I say this not only because it is fair, but it is right, and because a stronger, more inclusive economy is good for everyone. Then, now, next, Ontario's Women's Economic Empowerment Strategy is historic because it invests in women and their futures. It is historic because empowerment includes new legislation to help break down wage barriers women face in the workplace. Speaker, we're also taking steps to promote women's corporate leadership. We're working to ensure that women make up to at least 40% of the appointments to each provincial board and agency by December of 2019.
Answer.
We're also encouraging TSX-listed issuers to set and achieve a target of 30% women on their boards, and we are taking the lead on this. We've already taken that lead on
target. Thank you. Your question, the member from Sault Ste. Marie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Deputy Premier. The steel mill in Sault Ste. Marie, Algoma, will not be able to survive a 25% tariff on steel. Since the three U.S. tariff recommendations were first released just a few weeks ago, I have been trying to develop relationships with friends south of the border, specifically developed a great relationship with Michigan State Senator Wayne Schmidt. Senator Schmidt is equally concerned of the effect that these tariffs, specifically a closure of Algoma's mill, will have on his economy in Michigan. In fact, he stated to me just this past Tuesday that if Algoma closes, Michigan will immediately be forced into a recession. I'm working with the senator and other political representatives to convince the president that the U.S. economy needs us as much as we need them. My question, Mr. Speaker, for the deputy is, will you join me in my diplomatic efforts to obtain an exclusion to the 25% tariff in order to save the thousands of jobs in my community and in our province?
Thank you.
The Minister of Economic Development and Growth.
Economic Development and Growth.
Thanks very much, Speaker, and I thank the member from the Sault Ste. Marie for the question. Of course, repeatedly on this side of the House, the Premier, various ministers in our cabinet, backbenchers, everyone collectively has said repeatedly that we are determined as a government to do what is at our core, what is our responsibility to the people that we are proud to represent, Speaker, and that is to stand up at every turn for our workers and for our businesses. And we very clearly understand that in communities like Sault Ste. Marie and in Hamilton and in others, that if the Americans go forward with the tariffs on steel and aluminum that President Trump has referenced over the last number of days, that there would be very serious ramifications. And that's exactly why, Speaker, we have said repeatedly, and we've been working closely with our federal partners to make sure that Canada and Ontario can gain the exemption. My understanding is that there will be an update provided perhaps even later today. We'll continue to press hard and push hard, and that members' community can fully understand and appreciate our Premier and our government are standing beside them and right with them to make sure that we continue to provide support.
Supplementary, the member from Niagara West Glanbrook.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is also to the Deputy Premier. And Hamilton's steel industry and business community are also deeply concerned after the United States pledged to impose a 25% tariff on steel. Hamilton Chamber of Commerce President Keenan Loomis said this is the worst case scenario for Hamilton. And Loomis continued saying, ultimately, they're up to about, I think, 40,000 jobs or so that could be impacted in Hamilton by this announcement. That's 40,000 good, stable, well-paying jobs that are at risk because of the rise of protectionism. And this dangerous wave can be rolled back through diplomacy and negotiation so that the prosperity of Ontarians is safeguarded. And my question's nonpartisan. It's, will the government join members on this side of the House on our mission to ensure Canada is exempt from the exorbitant tariffs?
Thank you, Minister.
You know, Speaker, just because a member inserts the notion that this is not partisan into their question doesn't actually make all of us on this side forget where they were last week on these issues, Speaker. On Bill 194, legislation that our government introduced a number of days ago and have passed, the Fairness in Procurement legislation, Speaker, when members, including the member from Sault Ste. Marie and others on that side, had the opportunity to stand with us, but most importantly, Speaker, not just to stand with us, but to stand with the people that they are supposed to be representing and fighting for, they missed that opportunity, Speaker. So they didn't just miss the opportunity, Speaker. They repeatedly attacked our Premier and our government for doing what is at our core.
All sides. Come to order. And a reminder that some people are on warned. There is no point of order. Sit down. Finish, please.
As I was saying, on this side of the legislature, whether it's Bill 194, whether it's the tariffs for steel and aluminum, we will never apologize for standing up for the people, the workers, and the businesses of this province.
And I would expect those members to be
We have, before we do the vote, I want to do two things. First of all, to introduce a former member from Brampton North in the 36th and Brampton Centre from the 37th in the members, the West Members Gallery, Mr. Joe Spina. Welcome, Joe. Also, I do recognize there's a few points of order, and if they're not points of order, I'll sit you down real quick. Hang on, I'm not done. Because I have a sad announcement to make.
It happens.
But I do want to point out to the members that we've had a very strong, hardworking set of pages. It's their last day. We want to thank them for the work that they've done. Well done. They took a vote and said they're coming back next week. Thank you. I did see some people standing for points of order. The Minister of Northern Development and Mines.
Very much, Mr. Speaker. I just wanted to recognize once again Terry Armstrong, Chief of Police for Anishinaabe Asking Nation. Thank you very much for being here. Fabian Batiste, the board liaison from Anishinaabe Asking Nation, and my good friend Mike Metawaban as well. Thank you very much for being here. It's fantastic to have you here today.
Thank you. Culture, Food and Rural Affairs.
Mr. Speaker, at the West Public Gallery, I have some guests from Peterborough, Cedric Condon, Jim Dufresne, Marion Burton, who's the president of Peterborough District Labour Council, and Heather Brooks Hill.
Thank you. The member from Sault Ste. Marie.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And just to the member from Vaughan's comments, perhaps he wasn't paying attention.
The member will be seated. Order. Even after telling the member and being poked by somebody else to do it, I'm disappointed. We have a deferred vote on the motion, a third reading of Bill 175, and to implement measures with respect to policing, coroners, forensic laboratories, and to enact, amend, repeal certain other statutes and revoke a regulation. Call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bill.
All members, please take your seats.
On March 7, 2018, Madame Lavon moved the third reading of Bill 175, an act to implement measures with respect to policing, coroners, and forensic laboratories, and to enact, amend, and repeal certain other statutes and revoke regulations. All those in favour, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. McNackie.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Sousa.
Ms. Naidoo Harris.
Ms. Jasek.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Chan.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Duga.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Moridi.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Leo.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mrs. McGarry.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Madame de Rosier.
Madame de Rosier.
Mr. Codrey.
Mr. Codrey.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Mrs. Manga.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Mrs. Martin. Mrs. Martin.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Tavins.
Mr. Tavins.
Mr. Monta.
Mr. Monta.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time to be recognized by the clerk.
Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman. Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Miller-Perry-Sound-Muskoka.
Mr. Miller-Perry-Sound-Muskoka.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Romano.
Mr. Romano.
Mr. Osterhoff.
Mr. Osterhoff.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Coe.
Mr. Cho.
Mr. Cho.
The ayes are 59, the nays are 16.
The ayes being 59, the nays being 16, I declare the motion carried.
Third reading of the bill, pausing the lecture, this is projet de loi.
Be it resolved that the bill do now pass and be entitled as in the motion. There being no further deferred votes, this House stands recess until 1 p.m. this afternoon.